Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Millionaire Dentist Podcast, brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. On this podcast, we break down the world of dentistry finances and business practices to help you become the millionaire dentist you deserve to be. Please be advised, we do speak with an honest tongue and may not be safe for work.
Hello and welcome. This is Casey Hires back at the Millionaire Dentist Podcast in studio with co-host Jarrod Bridgman.
Casey, how are you?
Doing well. Let's talk about, I don't know.
Well, you had a really great topic, subject, not all CE is created equal.
Yeah.
Right. So this stemmed from a conversation we had off recording of, we had a few of our, teammates, crewmates out there at SmileCon over the past weekend.
Yeah. I feel like it's CE season. Actually, I was, this was the perfect double whammy. So I was out in the desert, of Las Vegas. There was an implant course that we have a nice relationship with. And so you have high achieving dentists learning implants, and then they bring us in to talk on the business side of dentistry, which is a nice 1-2 punch, I think, because there's always that pull and tug.
Much better than a sucker punch.
Much better.
Yeah.
But yeah, clinical versus other. But I got to do that. That was fun. And then we also had three of our team in Orlando for SmileCon,
right,
which is a large meeting, but that certainly cause some convo about CE, good CE, bad CE, indifferent CE, what that all looks like, what practice owners are looking for, what they're not.
Well, starting off, what would you consider a bad CE course?
So some of our team, they would, go in and listen to some different topics.
Right.
As a firm, we stay fresh on those things. And
we go to things so our clients don't have to.
Yeah. Right. Well, now, I mean, to be honest, our chief operations officer went in for a day and a half of high level meetings and ran into 4 or 5 clients and was in an interesting CE track and saw one of our clients come in and hey, what are you doing here? And our COO goes, what are you doing here? He goes, I attend these minimum quarterly to get all the information so that you don't have to. That's why you pay us. And he goes, oh shoot, I can go to the bar? He goes, yes, get out of here. I've got this. Like that, that's the point sometimes that even our clients will forget. But like, we're going to these, we're learning if there's anything new. But bad CE is a one trick pony.
Okay.
It's one idea over and over and over
for the hour or 2 hours or however long it's slotted for.
Yeah. And I listen, banks and practice management, they're important, but I'm gonna pick on them. One of those types of entities talking about the time value of money for 2 hours. Like, I got it. After about 18 minutes, get it. And so some of this CE,
you're a little slow. So, I mean.
That's right. Yeah. Sometimes I need the full 2 hours to get the one big idea. But there's a lot of CE that's just one idea over and over and over again. And it's.
And at the end of the day, it may not actually move any needles at all.
Correct. That is very well put.
When you could have, you as in the dentist or practice owner, may have been able to take a different CE course or something else entirely instead of, I don't want to say wasting your time for 2 hours, but.
Well, and that's the whole, it's not all equally, right? You get the booklets, you look at it. We're going to a pretty big event and it was interesting. Our topic, I think it's robust. I know it's robust. We were told by thousands of dentists it's robust. Some of the best they've ever heard.
Yep.
But
yours also scares them.
Oh yeah, because we're getting into the real deal that they don't talk about.
Spooky seasons. I want to talk about the scariness.
They have nightmares at night about and don't want anybody to know about. Yep. We're talking about it. But the constant, we're looking at the other topics and we're just like, oh my gosh, these are. We hope they don't take away from ours because they're at the same time and it's just such an elementary topic from entities that they'll bring us in on their behalf to speak because they know our stuff so good. But let's go to the clinical versus the other. That's such a topic where even like some well-known study clubs out there, they're just, we're clinical. It's like a badge of honor to them. So it's only clinical. And we've said this before. What do they tell us?
They say, we don't want clinical.
Well,
users.
We've got a lot of the clinical.
Yeah.
Right? And so.
Clinical to me sounds like it's very beneficial if you are on a path of deciding, hey, I want to learn a new technique.
Like the implant course. Like that's a big deal.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know what the analogy is, but it's like if you're trained in something and you do something all the time, why would you go travel to a course where you get it kind of reinforced or you learn a little hack that saves you. I don't know. It's
right.
It's fascinating, the badge of honor that clinical only CE has, yet what practice owners don't have is typically the non-clinical. Now, I get that when you're, again, nothing against these people,
sure,
but when your local insurance company or your local banker or your local Edward Jones person wants to talk about their little niche thing, that's frustrating.
Right.
Right?
Right.
But my gosh, they want to hear something that's new, something that's fresh, something that's robust, something that challenges them, something that they go, oh, crap. They know my dirty little secret that my overhead's high.
Something at the end will actually have a large benefit.
Well,
you know.
Well, I always tell them I'm not so arrogant to think I can solve all your problems because I don't know you or your practice.
Right.
But some general takeaways: picking at the scab a little bit.
Yep.
Getting into insurance adjustments. Getting into overhead.
Ugh.
Getting into employee wages. So many systems and processes and efficiencies. I think that's and we're not the only one that does that.
We are the best though.
That's good CE. Dude, I've sat in some CE courses, and when I was starting this journey of presenting, I don't want to say I doubted myself, but you're a little unsure. And I'd sat in about 10 different ones and I'm like, God, these are god awful. that kind of propelled me to be able to, the information needs to be shared. I'm simply the vessel. It's not about me.
Right.
But boy, did it help me feel much better about presenting it. But we still get pushback. Well, it's not clinical, and it's talking about,
Do you think it's because they're only seeing it at the surface level, like judging the book by its cover?
They're used to the one trick pony that's talking about personal financial planning because they need more clients sort of thing versus we source the money, we find the money, we help the money. So when you have hundreds of thousands more a year, well, we're going to probably invest it and save it and help your income. And so those are like the lightning rods that when the committees look at it, they'll go, oh, well, we don't want anybody talking about that.
Right.
But our pushback is, sorry, when you do these 27 things over 2 years, or when we do them for our clients,
right,
they have hundreds of thousands of dollars more. That needs to be discussed because that means debt reduction, save more cash flow at home, and ultimately a better retirement. So it's like we get into the work and the why, but if you create the money and the wealth, you want to talk about that too.
What recommendations do you have for somebody who's going to a conference of maybe sniffing out what's good versus bad in terms of CE?
I wish I had some advice. I mean, I look through the booklet, the ones we go to, I look at all the programs.
Right.
And you can get lost in it, man. And again, we're pretty on. I mean, hey, I am paid by Four Quadrants. I am presenting. We do these things.
Yep.
Like, I'm not hiding that.
Yep.
But the point is, we can't help everybody. I want most people to go back to their teams and demand better and go, here's a blueprint, high level. I need y'all to execute it.
Right.
But it's hard to decide which ones are good or bad. And we get a lot of students that come to ours because they're like, oh, I don't get any business training. I've got all the clinical. Mm-hmm. I want to learn. Well, that's great, but we're helping practice owners. So sometimes that doesn't even translate.
Yeah, because the students may not fully understand the numbers coming out of it. Like they won't know their debt and how much they owe and all these other things.
They don't have a practice.
They don't manage
and they're not going to remember it 4 years later when they do.
Right.
But I respect that they know that there's value to the topic.
Right. So if you've already been and you're a student, we'll see you in a couple of years.
All right, I always tell them, come back and see us. My card, stow it away in some drawer.
Yep.
And then when you buy your practice and you're pissed after 12 to 18 months.
Just look for that bright orange card.
There you go. Yeah. No, but I mean, CE is beautiful. And kudos to the dental community. These shows know what the draw is. I mean, they need good CE. There is a lot of good CE. It's easy too. There's, it's online. I don't recommend it. Let's be honest. You don't pay attention as much.
No, I'm actually doing a course right now. I'm trying to learn a software and I have a really hard time paying attention and working on it.
Oh, that's when you're always napping in here. And so
I am. So I sleep all the time.
Yeah. So, you're actually doing an online CE.
I am.
It's just, there's no energy to it.
Yeah, at all.
Joking with you, but, but that's true. I mean, don't settle for, I'm just going to do it online because it's easy. There's no energy. Like our clients, we recommend certain CE to them and they go meet people, and it's ideas and it's energy. And there's a lot too, that half the value is who you meet at some of these events.
Yep.
The other half is what you learn.
Yep.
But we don't give people a blueprint to fix it themselves.
Right.
That's a full-time job.
Yep.
They're already a full-time dentist and CEO, COO, chief marketing officer, chief technology officer, chief everything officer.
Babysitter.
Yeah. Adult babysitting. They don't have time to do it themselves, but, anyway.
So I really feel like the best you can do and hope for in terms of sniffing it out would just be research. Not only look at the title, look at the program, but may not hurt to look up that company and or person. Yeah,
look at the company. I mean, if it's again, some banks have good stuff, but if it's a bank, like most likely it's maybe going to be one idea. Right. A lot of financial planning. That's why it gives a bad name, because that there is a portion of that to ours, but most financial planning, it's a one trick pony. You're not learning anything. You're hearing it repeated for an hour.
Yep.
But yeah, that's probably the best advice I can give. By the way, quick story.
All right.
I'm in Vegas. I've got a couple hours to kill before dinner. Now by myself. And sure. I go, I'm going to lose X amount of money. How do I want to lose it? That was my mentality. And normally I'm cup half full, but let's be honest, it's Vegas.
Right.
I like roulette and I like blackjack. So I decide that's where I'm going to go lose my money. And I had accepted that. I sit down and they go, sir, would you like to play roulette? Like straightened up the tables. It was just me. I go, yeah, I think I would. And bring me a Budweiser while you're at it. Right. And so I put $10 on a color on roulette. I put $10 on two numbers on roulette because the minimums are obscenely high.
Right.
First spin, it hits my number for $350. And I just look at the guy and he goes, wow, that didn't happen often. And the pit boss goes, first spin? I go, yeah. I go, I don't really know what to do or say. And he goes, take your money and run. He literally said that. And I did. It was so weird. I was ready to lose.
Yeah.
Now I still had 2 hours to kill. So I called my wife and I told her what happened. And she's like, oh, that's great. Didn't really get the reaction I wanted. And then I go play blackjack.
So you should have called me.
I should have. You'd have been like, that's awesome. Yeah. Then I go play blackjack. Well, over the next 2 hours, I still probably up $100, but
yeah,
pissed it away.
Yep.
Real quick, playing with these two young dudes, it was a weird vibe. They're from Cornell. They do a class trip. Where'd you grow up? Beverly Hills. He's got these sweats. He's doing $300 bets on blackjack. And he's putting the hundreds in his sweats sound like he's got, you know, $5,000 in it. Well, he's counting cards. They actually kicked him out. I'm like, this is like a movie. The kids from Cornell are coming to take down Vegas. I mean, I'm sitting here like, whoa. And then once they left, because I was stacking them up.
Yeah.
Because they realized I knew how to play blackjack. But then once they left, my stack
started going down. So you're benefiting from someone else counting cards?
I play blackjack how I play blackjack. And whatever the hell they were doing, it was all working out for all of us. And then they changed dealers and they changed decks. And then they kicked the guy, said his time had expired. He's unable to play. And I'm like, are you guys from Cornell taking down the Bellagio? You know? And he's just like looking at me with this death look. And I'm like, I don't know what the hell's going on. Time to go eat some dinner.
Casey,
story time over, Jarrod?
It is over. Casey, if someone wanted to come and get some CE and hear some really important and beneficial information, where can they go?
Don't you run a website for us?
I do. It's called fourquadrantsadvisory.com. Go to the events tab. We've got our upcoming events that we host ourselves. It does not show some of the bigger ones, but we're a lot of things out there. Just check us out. Subscribe to our events newsletter, and we will send out emails letting you know where we're going to be next in person. All right. Thanks, Casey.
Don't play roulette. It normally doesn't happen like that.
Okay. All right. I won't.
That's all the time we have today. Thank you to our guests for their insight and for sharing some really great information. And thank you to you, the listener, for tuning in. The Millionaire Dentist Podcast is brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. To see if they might be a good fit for you and your practice, go on over to fourquadrantsadvisory.com and see why year after year they retain over 95% of their clients. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next time.